the choir to please keep their mouth quiet for now so that we can get our team. You are giving us a team that is not according to team. So please, God give us Christian hope. Home where the Bible is loved and taught. Home where the Master's will. Home crown where beauty thy love has wrought. God give us Christian hope. God give us Christian hope. All right. So let's go now. Want to go together, all of us, from one.
God give us Christian hope. God let us find us sweet love and all. God let us find us with sweet love. God let us
guilty thy love has wrought. God give us grace. Thank you this afternoon for another time. Thank you for the opportunity of sitting together as couples in ministry, seeking to understand what your will for us is. And how do we make the best of our matrimony for the ministry unto which you have called us? We need your hand on our lives now. We pray that there will be light, there will be insight, there will be revelation. We ask that above all, cause the love of Jesus to be spread in our hearts for one another, so that the things that you intend to bring about when you said it is not good for the man to be alone, may our marriage bring such increase unto the ministry to which you have called us. Thank you, Father. In Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed. Amen. Thank you very much. Yesterday, we left you with an assignment, which we said, we would like to go from there so that we can face the matter of practical steps onto partnering together with your spouse. So we left two issues which we are just going to highlight in very few minutes, because we are still going to be discussing them when we go to the practical side of our discussion today. One of the reasons why we decided to bring out an outline is such that wherever we stop, you are able to continue both to study together and to draw further issues. When we are about to conclude, we're going to be introducing some materials which we have worked upon for several years in this aspect of maximizing our matrimony for ministry. We will be introducing them in case you have opportunity of getting some of them as you go about in different parts of the country. Now, two passages that I would like us to quickly read, just to tie up what we said yesterday and the assignment we left you with. I want us to read Ecclesiastes chapter 4. We are reading Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and we'd like to read from verse 9. I know we could read from verse 30, but I want to ask you to read from verse 9, verse 9, verse 10, verse 11, and verse 12. We will ask Sashade to please start to read that passage for us, and then we just draw quick issues and go on. Yes, ma'am.
Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 to 12.
Are you hearing her at the back? What's happening to your mic? All right.
Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 to 12.
Yes, sir.
Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Thank you very much. Two, the Bible says, are better than one. And when we just look at the outline which that passage provides for us, you will see areas in which couples, especially couples in ministry, are expected to partner together. I will just outline them. When we get to practical steps, we shall be discussing them eventually, because they are critical aspects in which we need to partner. First, it says two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. That's number one. We are noting that when two labor together, there's good reward that comes out of their ministry, out of their labor. Yesterday we noted There's not the question of incompetence. It's not that the man, we are saying you are incompetent. We are only talking about incompleteness. The matter that God has raised with us is not incompetence, but what? Incompleteness. It is that as competent as you are, there is a structural omission that will continue to characterize your ministry if your wife has not contributed that portion that God had taken from you in order to make up for you. Not incompetent. So we don't say a man is incompetent. We say that man, laboring alone, is doing an incomplete work. What he does is only a fraction of what he could have achieved by God. So the Bible said two are better than one. And we want to establish that it will always bring increase. You will always have good reward for your labor when the two of you agree to labor together in any matter. Even when we have to, work, say if I'm working on a book, there's no way I can allow a book to go out unless my wife has made an input. And I suddenly discovered that there are many things that I thought had been put well. But when she comes with the diagnostic eye of a woman, she says, there's something omitted here. We need to add this here. We need to bring this together here. And I just realized that when a man decides to go alone, look at what the Bible says. It said, but woe to him that is alone when he falls, for he has no one, he has not another to help him up. Why, you might imagine that any two people can work together like that. But we found that the truth of the matter is that the two that God is really focusing upon are these two people that he has put together, who are not supposed to be two anymore, but one flesh. We find that the second reason why God wants us to work together is to forestall a fall. If a man will work closely with his wife and they will open up to relate together, then the Bible says the possibility of falling actually is reduced completely. It said, because if one fall, what will the other one do? They will lift him up. And that also goes to buttress the issue we began to raise yesterday, that the woman that God had in mind is a helpmeet. It's a woman that is strong enough to lift up her husband when he is beginning to fall out. It's a woman that is articulate enough, is spiritual enough, as to bring words of comfort, words of encouragement, and if possible, words of rebuke in order to help her husband up. If a man will work closely with her husband, he will never be ridiculed in the public. Because the issues that the public were going to start pointing out, if you have been listening to your wife, she will have pointed it out many, many times. Am I right? One of the issues is that the wife is actually, most of the time, more sensitive to the environment, to how people think, how people feel, how people look at you. Wives are more sensitive to people's attitude and comments than most men. For a man, he doesn't worry. Most men, they don't actually look at people's faces. They simply speak, and they use words only to communicate the idea in their mind. But for the woman, by the manufacturer's design, she does not only hear words. She's concerned about how you looked, how you put your face when you were speaking, and how you say it. All of this is what a woman looks together before she can conclude what you have said. When we come to practical steps, we'll be talking about that later. But let's quickly note that if a woman would be allowed to contribute to the ministry of her husband, you are not likely to fall. Even in the parish, you are not likely to make very grave mistakes because she's very sensitive. Many of you will bear me witness that sometimes what you thought is not anything, is not important. When your wife will speak about it and say, Kai, the way that man is putting his face, I think he's not happy. Don't you think you should talk to him again and find out what is the problem? Sometimes the other say, well, what is it? Huh? If he's not happy, he's not happy. I've said my own. The wife said, no, I know you have said it, but I think it might be useful if you check it again. The reason is because by the way God makes a woman, God makes them to pay attention to details, to pay attention to little issues, and they dwell much more in the realm of feelings than in the realm of facts. Of course, if a man would live all his life by feelings, that man would have become a woman long ago. Isn't it? So what God's plan is that, yes, you will be strong, you'll be factual, you'll be focused, you will set the agenda as a man, but the feelings, the little things that will make things to be connected, God placed that in your wife. So we're saying that God designed that you not be alone. Because when you are alone, when you fall into a mistake, sometimes when you are preaching, you have made a statement that is very strong in your mind, but you are not thinking of how it is landing on the audience. But because your wife is sensitive in the audience, she's able to pick it up and say, that thing you said, I know what you wanted to say, but this is how it landed. If you have an opportunity, I think you should say it again. Now, I know many husbands, they say, are you going to teach me how to preach? She's not teaching you how to preach. She's helping you to preach well. What did I say? She's helping you to preach well, for your messages to become sharper and much more focused. Now, that's the second need why we have to partner. He said, two are better than one. For if one should fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falls, for he has not another one to help him up. So, we are noting that the ministry of the wife is to help him up. It's not to pull him down. We are going to be discussing on this as we go to practical steps, but we just want to outline it. What is the third issue where we need to partner? And this is very interesting. Again, if two lie together, they have heat. That's how King James put it. But how can one be warm alone. Hallelujah. You are not hearing me at all. Are you hearing me? This is the third aspect where partnering together as husband and wife becomes critical. When they lie together, God Himself knows that sometimes you have preached hot on the pulpit. You only get to the room shivering, feeling cold. You are wondering whether you preach properly. Sometimes the devil is waiting to say, what have you said altogether? Woe to that man when he had finished preaching, he went home alone. For the warmth of fellowship, for the warmth of relationship, and for the warmth of conjugal relationship, conjugal sex, God said, how can a man be warm alone? And sometimes you don't know that you need a blanket. And the blanket you need to take away cold, hallelujah, is not the woolen blanket. Where is that blanket? I'm not seeing you again. Where is that blanket? That blanket is here. The Bible says when two lie together, they will keep warm. The warmth of acceptance. Sometimes a husband has gone out, he has faced rejection. He said something, somebody argued with him. The only place he's looking forward to go where he could be accepted and he could feel warm and he could feel, you know, resuscitated is at home. When we come to that practical point, we'll be discussing, because sometimes wives, they don't understand. Sometimes women, wives, especially wives of preachers, they think that their husband is so spiritual, he's so much in the spirit, that he doesn't feel cold. And several preachers, pastors, especially when they are still growing, when they are still young in their marriage, in their relationship, I don't think there's any time a man will not need the warmth of his wife. But I thought to say that at the earlier part of marriage, it used to be much more acute. And sometimes the man of God is preparing to go and preach. Suddenly he's feeling cold and he wants to grab the wife. And he will say, no, you are preaching, go and preach first. He said, no. Let's just do it before I go. It will release the anointing. You know, that kind of thing. If it is inside your marriage, if it is in your matrimony, it is not bad. It is God that provided it. And we need to partner together in it. Hallelujah. Am I communicating with you? Please don't let your husband feel cold, though. Because there are all these other waiting girls that are coming around. They are bringing pepper soup. They are saying, oh, Pastor, I thank God for your message. Everything is nice. That man is resisting those ones. But when he comes home, that's a welcome. You are not well finished. And we are saying you should bring something, you are not. And the man is sitting down there and say, oh, is that what I will be welcome with when I'm just coming from the pulpit? Can a man be warm alone? Please answer that question. Can a man be warm alone? It's very critical, the partnering together, even in our relationship. And you will notice that when they lie together, God was not expecting you to to sleep in two rooms apart. I'm hearing some man of God say, well, he just wants to be in the spirit. Excuse me. That spirit that is taking you away and you are separating your bed, we need to suspect that spirit. Please, may the Lord help us in the name of Jesus Christ. What is the number four issue that comes out here as the reason for partnering? Warfare. Do you know that ministry is a warfare? Eh? Do you know that when you engage in active ministry, when you are preaching to save souls, when you are preaching to snatch people from the jaw of Satan and from the kingdom of darkness, do you know that you are in a warfare? Eh? And do you know that many, many times the enemy is targeting you? He's targeting the man of God. He's waiting to shoot at him to see whether he can bring him down. Warfare. And God knows that you cannot be in the ministry without a warfare. And we see God saying, if one prevail against him, two shall do what? Withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Hallelujah. So we see partnering together for warfare, for spiritual warfare, to withstand everything the enemy is bringing against us. I do remember several times that in our serving God, we faced serious challenge, serious rejection, serious blackmail, serious criticism. And sometimes I will go out after I finish preaching, I'll just see some group of men will come around and say, hey, well, we don't agree. What did you say? At first I go and sit in their midst, I will table the message again. They say, no, we don't agree. And I'm coming back home confused. One day I came back home, I said, Mommy, it's time to pack out of this place. Let's go to where we are needed, where the word of God will be accepted. I'm tired of staying with these people. And I thought my wife will follow me and say, let's pack. She asked me one question that finished everything. She said, before we came here, God spoke to you clearly, isn't it? I said, yes. And you told me that God led us here. I said, yes. I also prayed, and the Lord told me that I should follow you to this place. When we move here now, who will you say has led you to this, to move out? My mouth kept shut. And where will you go? And you will be sure that God sent us there. And I hear my wife say, my husband, we are not going anywhere. We will stand and resist this battle until God gives us the victory. That's why we are in Boko. I will have left that place, and maybe you will never have heard of me again. I would have been somewhere doing something. I don't know what I would have been doing. But when she came on with that and said, we are praying, and I thank God for blessing me with a woman who prays. She did not only say, we will pray. She just went into prayer. When Baba was teaching us about the Holy Ghost and capacity to travel in the place of prayer, I cannot thank Baba Bishop Sam enough, because there comes a time in your ministry that the battle is fierce. The devil wants to push you out of your place of divine posting, but he wants to change your focus and give you something else to be doing. At that time, you need a wife who is not crying for food, who is not saying, the place is difficult, let's just find somewhere else. No. You need a wife who says, no, this is the enemy. Let's stand up and fight. And when I see her laboring in prayer, all my discouragement just disappeared. I just found myself, yes, Satan, you didn't bring us here. You cannot take us out. We have come. We will see the glory of the Lord in the land of the living. I remember after that matter of prayer and warfare, one of the days God said, take your, I think I was still riding bicycle then, motorbike. Said, take your motorbike and go around. And I was going from one place to another, from one church to another, and I would hear people making noise from afar. When I would get there, there would be about three people speaking into the microphone. And the Lord is saying, these are the people that want to chase you out of this land. What are they doing? I'll go to another place. I'll go to another place. By the time I return, I told my wife, say, we are going nowhere. We will stay here until we see the glory of God breaking forth. Warfare. That time, may I inform you, other prayer partners may not be able to stand with you. Are you hearing me? At that time, when the enemy singles you out and wants to isolate you for slaughter, the greatest help you need is in the woman that is one with you. A twofold cord bound together around the Lord is not easily broken. Hallelujah. Now, the last passage that we want to highlight, that Malachi chapter 2, verse 13 to 15. We are only laying all of these as principles that we need to understand that there is more to our marriage than just that your wife is cooking food for the children. Praise the Lord. There's more to our matrimony than that you just have a husband who comes back home every time and is coming with a turkey or dry fish or something like that. No. There's something more to do in the mind of God. That's why you are there. And our prayer is that while we examine this issue of partnering together for life and for ministry, the Lord will help us to lay hold on that which is critical. Malachi chapter 2. Mom, please help us. 13, 14, and 15. Now, if somebody has Living Bible, Old Living Bible, we would like you to please help us read. Or you have something like that. Okay. Now, let's go to Malachi chapter 2. Please, if you can rush to Malachi chapter 2, that will be of help to us. Yes, ma'am.
Malachi chapter. From verse 13.
Verse 13, yes.
And this is the second thing you do. You cover the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping and crying, so he does not regard the offering anymore, nor receive it with goodwill from your hand. Yet you say, for what reason? Because the Lord has been witness between you and the wife of your youth, with whom you have dealt treacherously. Yet she is your companion and your wife by covenant. But did he not make them one, having a remnant of the Spirit? And why one? He seeks godly offspring. Therefore, take heed to your spirit, and let none deal treacherously with the wife of his youth.
Right. I would like us to read it very quickly from Living Bible. I need somebody's grinding Good News Bible. Can you help us? Is it? There's a Living Bible there. Old Living, not New Living Translation. Yes, sir. Okay.
And you receive no blessings from him. Why has God abandoned us? You cry. I'll tell you why. It is because the Lord has seen your treachery in divorcing your wives who have been faithful to you through the years. The companions you promised to care for and keep. You were united to your wife by the Lord in God's wise plan. When you married, the two of you became one person.
The two of you became how many? One person.
In his sight.
In God's sight.
And what does he want? Godly children from your union. Therefore, guard your passions. Keep faith with the wife of your youth.
Thank you very much. That's one more dimension that we need to add when we are looking at partnering. We are laying principles now. May we know, brothers and sisters, and you know, this particular chapter was addressing priests. It was addressing priests. If you read Malachi from chapter 2 from verse 1, he talked about priests. Actually, if you read from verse 1, you will notice that, and now, O you priests, this commandment is for you. Did you understand that now? This particular chapter is for you, priests. And there are two things that God complained about. He complained about the priests who have corrupted ministry by their life of sin. Priests who no longer speak the word of God, who, you know, has allowed iniquity to reduce the word of God. But now the second issue that hinders God from answering prayer was what he said there. Another thing you do, the second thing you do, you fill the Lord's altar with your cries and prayers. And the Lord does not regard your ministry anymore. And you say, why? And sometimes, you know, we don't understand why. Why is heaven closed over our heads? Why is our ministry struggling? And God said, because I am a witness. I am a witness between you and your wife. I realize men of God who are in ministry, there is one place that will be the greatest entrance to your ministry, is your matrimony. Am I communicating with you? Your matrimony, your marriage, is a very critical point in whether God will hear your prayer or not. And sometimes people gather for us to pray for them, for us to bless them. But your own marriage has turned the eyes of God away. Can you imagine that all your parishioners are unfortunate? Because you are the one to pronounce blessing. And heaven says, get away, I don't need it. How terrible that would be. So he said, and you cry, why? He said, because I'm a witness between you and your wife, with whom you are handling roughly. He used the word terrorously, inconsiderably. He said, do you not know that when you got married, your wife became a partner with you in receiving the gift and the grace of life. Since the day you got married, God opened a joint account for you and your wife in heaven. Oh, brothers, are you hearing me? You are not with me again. Are you with me? The day you said yes on the altar, that was the day God did not see you again as separate entity. He sees you and your wife as one person. Every time you table a request to heaven, they are checking the co-signatory. They are asking, where is the signature of his wife in this request? Where is the signature of your husband in this request? And whensoever they can see that something is not going well at home, they say, you know how the bankers, when you send in a check and they say the check has bounced, they used to write something there, RTD. What's the meaning of RTD? Return to drawer. Irregular signature. Many, many prayers have been turned back from the ceiling. And not because of anything else, but because Baba is the witness between you and your wife. God is looking for something, he's looking for an offspring, something that will spring forth from your matrimony. If we do not partner together, we are having a critical hindrance to our ministry already. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 7. Please read 1 Peter 3 verse 7. And then I will have finished the highlights. And then we are going now practicality. We already now have agreed that we must partner together. Have we agreed that we must partner together? Right. And that it is the will of God for us, if we are going to see great, great reward in our ministries. Please help us read
1 Peter 3, 7.
Yes.
Husbands, likewise.
Husbands, likewise.
Dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered.
Where is that our Living Bible reader? Let me just depend on you for now. Just read verse 7.
You husbands must be careful of your wives, being thoughtful of their needs and honoring them as the weaker sex. Remember that you and your wife are partners in receiving God's blessings.
You and your wife, you are partners in receiving God's blessings. That means you have a joint account. Yes, sir.
And if you don't treat her as you should, your prayers will not get ready answers.
So, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So while we begin to discuss practical steps, our first emphasis that we have drawn is to show you the biblical basis, the rationale, the fact that once you are married, there is no going back but to connect, to partner, to work together. God himself said it's not good for you to be alone. And I want to ask that you will agree that it's not good to be alone. Hallelujah. Now, when we were ending yesterday, there were questions about how will a woman not take over? What is the boundary of a woman? We said today, when we go on the practical issues, they will come out. And we'll be discussing them practically. So please take your outline with us now and go with us to practical steps onto partnering with your spouse. Now, Sister Shade, you will please begin to read for us. And can I appoint people to help us read some passages as we are going on? Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 19, verse 4 to 6. Can we have someone to help us read that? Matthew 19, 4 to 6. I've not seen a hand yet. All right, there's a hand. You will stand and read when we're there. We will need 1 Peter chapter 3. They put 1 Peter chapter 3 as if we are going to read the whole chapter. We cannot read the whole chapter. We will only read verse 1 to verse 7. But we will read verse 1 to verse 2, or even up to verse 3. We'll read that in the Amplified Version. Is anybody carrying Amplified Bible to help us? Amplified Bible Version? Alright, there's an Amplified. Thank you. Once we are reading 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 and 2, you help us read Amplified. But then I will request someone to help us read. I will ask Mama Bishop here. Yes, ma'am. You help us read verse 1 to 7 from your version. First Peter chapter 3, 1 to 7. When you finish, the man with Amplified will help us read verse 1 and 2. Are we following? Now, Genesis chapter 2, 23 and 24. We read it before yesterday, but we can read it again. Who is going to take that for us? Yes, it is Mama Bishop. When I'm ready, she will read for me. All right. Verse 23 and 24. I need another lady to help us read. Where is somebody? All right. Thank you. Now, and Sister Shade, you will just conclude with Ephesians 5, 22 to 23. That thing should be 22 to 23. Now, Deuteronomy 22, 5. We will read that from here. Right. Can you start with us now?
Partnering not as equals and mates, but as the head and the body. Matthew 19, 4 to 6.
Matthew 19, 4. And he answered and said unto them, Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female?
Okay.
And said, For this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Verse 6. Wherefore, they are no more one, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder.
1 Peter 3.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Yes. Mom, yes. 1 Peter 3, 1 to 7.
1 Peter 3, 1 to 7. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not in word, they also may, without the word, be won by the conversation of the wife, while they behold your chaste conversation, coupled with fear, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair, and of wearing of gold, and of putting on apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. For after this manner in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife, as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of God of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amplified, verse 1 and 2.
Verse 1. You married women, be submissive to your own husband. Subordinate yourselves as being secondary to and dependent on them, and adapt yourselves to them, so that even if any do not obey the word of God, they may be won over by discussion.
You have missed it now.
They may be won over not by discussion, but by the godly life of their wives, when they observe the pure and modest way in which you conduct yourselves, together with your reverence for your husband. You are to feel for him all that reverence includes: to respect, defer to, revere him, to honor, esteem, appreciate, prize, and in the human sense, to adore him, that is, to admire, praise, be devoted to, deeply love, and enjoy your husband.
Wow. Are we together? So, go ahead, Mama.
Genesis chapter 2, verses 23 and 24.
Somebody agreed to read from that side. Where is the person?
Genesis chapter 2, verse 23 and 24. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. And we will read Deuteronomy 22, verse 5 from here. Are you there? Or should I read?
Deuteronomy 22, verse 5. A woman shall not wear anything that pertains to a man, nor shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all who do so are an abomination to the Lord your God.
Ephesians 5, 22 and 23.
Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body.
All right. So, would you like to please bring an insight onto practical steps on the partnering? And we are noting that first, we don't partner together as equals and mates, but as the head and the body. Yes, ma'am.
From the Matthew scripture, Matthew 19, 4 to 6, we saw the Lord saying, when he was answering those Pharisees, have you not read that he who made them in the beginning made them male and female? And in partnering together, there is an understanding that we must have. We are male and female, and the male is not equal to the female. The female is not equal to the male. And he didn't also say, he who made them at the beginning made them male and male, or female and female. So that rules out homosexuality and lesbianism. He made them male and female. And for the male, even the physical outlook of the male is different from that of the female. And so if we are going to partner together successfully, it's important to understand the make of the female and that of the male, so as to be able to dwell together with understanding. That's the first issue there. The male is different from the female. I don't know whether I should go on.
Go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead.
With the differences, because that's the first thing that we need to understand from the scriptures we are reading here. The male, as we have said, is different in outlook than, different from the female. And even in perspective, the male perspective of things is different from the female perspective. It is when both of them complement that it gives rise to a wholesome relationship and a wholesome kind of ministry. For example, even in everyday life, we know that females' response to situations, especially situations that touch on the emotion, is different from the male response. Females normally, most of the time, they respond to things that pain them by weeping and shedding tears. It's easy for a woman to weep, easier than the male.
And if you see a man weeping all the time,
then he has become the female.
There's a problem.
The reason we need to understand this is that between husband and wife, sometimes when we encounter things that pain us so much, especially things that touch us in the heart, even issues about children, things that hurt, while it is easier for us to respond by weeping and sobbing, a man's eyes will be dry. And so the woman may likely say, look at you, you don't even feel anything about this matter. It's not that he doesn't feel. He feels, but the response of the male to such situations is different from that of the female. He may just keep quiet and he's walking about. It's not that he's not thinking. He's thinking about it and what to do about it. But if we expect our husband to weep as we weep, then we make a female out of them.
Wow. Are you following now? So, just to ask before you go ahead, what it means then is that by manufacturer's design, we are not duplicates. Your husband is not a duplicate of you. So his attitude is not the same. For example, now she has just talked about response, emotional response. Do you know that for a man to weep, to shed tears, God, that thing must have gone beyond control. Actually, do you know that in our culture, it is not good for a man to do what? To be crying. So are you crying like a woman? You know, that's what they will say. You're a man. Praise up as a man. Wipe off your eyes. Because if you are crying, how will you provide leadership for your wife? Their response is not that a man does not think. He's thinking. But maybe before she comes on, because you need to help us with this, the way the mind of a man operates is not the same as the way the mind of a woman operates. Can I explain a bit? Because I want her to come on and tell us how the woman, how she thinks, how she listens. So that husbands, when you are relating with your wife, you must relate with them according to knowledge. Most of what is causing confusion in marriages is simply because you have not read the manufacturer's manual. That he who made them in the beginning, how did he make them? Male and female. And we need to know that. Do you know that for a man, his mind operates like a shelf? If you see your bookshelf, look at this now. Did you see how I'm arranging this? This is how the man's mind is arranged, like a shelf. Each of the issues that you see here, they are standing on their own. So when a man wants to deal with an issue, he just pulls it out. Other issues are there. And he's dealing with it. When he finishes that, he will slot it back. Now, so it is possible that your wife, your husband can put several issues together at the same time. You are telling him about children, you are telling him about this, he says, okay, no problem, we will handle it. Meanwhile, the issue that is coming to his mind that he wants to deal with now, is sex. Are you hearing me now? The woman is saying, no, he said, no. When we finish it, we'll handle that one also. Because in his mind, they are standing apart. But the woman's mind is like this. It's a pile. Are you understanding? So, what happens is that there is no way. And you see, the latest issue that happens comes on top. So if anything happens suddenly now, it comes on top of everything else. So for the woman, you cannot access what is here until you first help your wife to download. You download. Unless you help her, you cannot have access to this thing that you are looking for. Are you hearing me now? The husband comes and says, no, let's just do it now, quick. He said, wait, there are issues we have to discuss. Then when you say, okay, what are the issues? Then she will start. You say, no, go straight to the point. He said, I am coming. Have you understood that now? Why? Because everything for your wife is a pile. And unless a husband is available to help us help her offload, she's not available for whatever else that is under. And so, when you are relating a man and his wife, they need to understand that. That your husband can keep a matter in the office pending. He has not finished though. He just decided to go. A woman cannot do that. If there is a matter that has not been resolved, there is no way you can get your wife to do other things. The reason is because that is the uppermost issue on the mind, and until it is removed, she is not available for another. I don't know whether you are hearing what I am saying. So, mommy, go ahead. How does a woman respond to words?
There are other differences in terms of the male and the female, which we must understand. There was a study that was conducted many years ago in the United Kingdom where the differences between the male and the female sexes were discovered. It was discovered that for a woman, the home is a place to build relationships. It's a place to interact. It's a place to build, to have warmth of fellowship, warmth of relationship. But for the male, it was discovered that the home is a place to relax. It's a place to rest. So this becomes a conflict when the man comes back home and he wants to relax. He puts one leg on the center table and the other leg down, and he wants to watch television or read newspaper. For the wife is saying, come, darling, there's something I need to tell you. Something happened when you were away. And then the man is saying, oh no, I just came home to rest. Don't trouble me again. Let me rest. That's the difference. There's a difference between the male and the female in terms of the home. The woman wants to build relationship, but the man wants to rest. There must be understanding for one another. If we are going to be able to partner together, we must understand the difference between the male and the female. While the man is given opportunity to rest, the man also should understand that the woman wants to build relationship. Maybe that's why God says a wise woman builds her home. The main building of the home is in the hands of the woman, because a woman relates, connects, builds relationship so that things can go on fine, whereas the man wants to rest. Another thing that was discovered is that the woman values, uses words to build relationship, and values words like treasure. But the man uses words just to express facts, and it doesn't matter whether it's to build relationship or to break it. He just speaks straight. Hey. But the woman uses words, and she wants words to be used to build relationship. And whatever words she hears, she values it like a treasure. That's why it's important that as men, we must understand our wives for that. And we don't use words anyhow. We don't just speak. If you speak good words, she will keep it. If you speak bad words, she will equally keep it, and it may be difficult to download, except the Lord has helped her.
Right.
We must be mindful of
right.
The use of words.
Wait. Let's wait here a bit. There are two issues she has raised now that I want us to note. A woman's understanding of a home is what? Is to build relationship, friendship, and discuss. So many things will have happened when she went to market when she went to school and all of that, and everything she saw. She said, when my husband comes, I will do what?
I will tell him.
I will tell him. So when the husband comes back, in his own mind, that I've walked and walked and walked, I'm just going home to sleep, eat, relax, sleep. Now, here's a woman that has been piling up issues, waiting for you. Now you come back, he said, food. He said, your food is ready, we are going to eat, but there are issues we need to talk. When I went to market today, and then the husband said, what concerns me with market? When your wife begins to tell the story of how when she was going, she wanted to negotiate a corner and a motorbike rider was almost crushing her, and I said, Jesus! Then you know the husband is saying, so, but you don't have accident. Thank God, thank God. The wife is saying, you don't understand, you don't understand. Let me explain to you how it happened. Have you understood what I'm talking about now? Aha. So you see that challenge. Now, how many of you husbands, listen to me, when you have gone for a meeting, a 5-day conference, when you come back home, and your wife say, how was the meeting? Fine. Thank God. In fact, the meeting is good. That's a 5-day meeting. He has reported it in 5 minutes. Your wife will say, is that all? He say, I tell you, in fact, God just moved mightily. God just moved. Praise the Lord. Where's my food? Now, but when it is your wife that went for a 1-day conference, if you make a mistake of saying, how is the meeting? Aha. Your wife will say, I am coming. Then she will start reporting that meeting. In fact, when we started the journey, that was the first miracle. By the time we were arriving at Bariga, wow, there was terrible ghost flow. The husband said, I know you got there. So, how did it go? He said, wait. I'm coming. Now, how many of you have experienced what we are talking about? Aha. Now, you can see the trouble now. What is the trouble? The husband is only looking for facts. And anything that is not factual, the husband is not interested. But the wife uses every opportunity to tell the story, to highlight the things that affected her, so that the husband can be part of it, and then they can have relationship. My wife said, woman treasures words. Please, I want some sisters to please help me here, because we don't want to be speaking arbitrarily. Mama Bishop, Mama Chairman, please, sorry to trouble you. When Bishop Henry, he wasn't bishop that time, when he was coming and he was moving around, he wrote some letters. Abby?
Yes.
He wrote you some letters. Some of those sweet, sweet letters where he was expressing everything. Please explain to us quietly, where are those letters now?
Most of them are still intact.
Did you hear that? Most of those letters are still intact. She's keeping it somewhere. After several years, the letters are still there. What you said to your wife when you were just cutting is there in the archives. Do you know that once a wife, when she is relaxed, what do you do to it sometimes?
Read them over again.
She reads them over again and smiles. And say, Henry, this is the letter you wrote me. Then the other one says, when did I do that? When did I say that? I can't remember. Why is it that a man doesn't remember? It's because a man only uses words to express an idea, to get certain things done. And once it is done, he has deleted it. I want you to be careful. All the texts you have sent to your wife, go and check her phone number. Those texts are still there. Especially wherever you say something that is very touchy, sweet, she kisses it. And many pastors have run into problems because you send text to a girl, to a sister. You don't know that she's keeping it though. They don't delete such things because words are important. They are their treasure. And they keep it very well. But for a man, he only uses words to say what he wants to say, and after that, he deletes it. So many, many times, our building partnership is very critical. Communication means too much to a woman. A woman values communication because it is the expression of her feelings, and it is what she uses to measure how much valuable she is to you. But the husband, he just uses words just to say something. So you meet a husband and say, well, what I'm telling you is that I don't like that thing. Period. And then he turns to his Bible or turns to his computer and he is doing other things. And the wife is sitting for the next 2 hours doing what? Looking at, why did he talk like that? Why did he frown his face? What does it mean? See how he just does shakala like that. Is that how to talk to somebody? He doesn't even care. So when the wife come and say, he said, what have I done? He said, what have you not done? What have you not done? We are talking and you just like that. Like how? You see, husband will say, like how? What have I said? I only told you that I don't like that thing. That's all I said. I didn't say anything. He said, you didn't say anything. You said something. The way you put your face, the way you raise your voice, the way you talk abruptly, the way you beat your hand. The man said, how did I do my hand? How did I talk? Now that's the trouble. For a wife is very, very concerned, not only about the words you speak, the atmosphere of it, the manner in which you say it, your facial expression when you express it, and even your gesticulation about it. They all mean a lot to a wife. And so sometimes you are wondering, what is my wife worried about? Wives are only crying for one thing. They are crying for fellowship. They are crying for relationship. They are crying. You see, a woman feels nice when the husband comes back and you stretch your leg and she's telling you stories. And as she's talking, you say, what? So that's how it is. The more you are saying that, the more she's releasing. The more she's talking, more saying, you see? He said, so that's how it is. Say, yes. In fact, my husband, I need to tell you something more. What you thought would be a 5 minutes, your wife just enjoys it. If it goes to 1 hour, even 2 hours, she's just on enjoying herself. You say, but the time you say, where are we going? Let's just talk. Pastors, are you with me? That to me is a very big tension in building partnership. Partnering together, we need to partner with understanding that he who made them at the beginning, how did he make them? Male and female. One more thing before I ask her to say something more if she wants. Do you know that the male man that we are, by nature, we only see the end of a matter. We don't really worry how we get there. It is only the woman that God has endowed with capacity of details. Philos. How many of you have made a mistake of meeting people in church after service without consulting your wife? You just said, just come to the vicarage and just have a meal before you go. Husband, tell me, is it true? You have invited people. They have landed. Madam has not been told. And then as they are landing, you just say, you know, they need to eat, or we need to get food for them right now. Suddenly, you have not thought that to bring a meal from the kitchen to the table, it will take a while. You have not thought like that. You've not thought about what do we have in the kitchen. The husband just knows that there will be food. It is the woman that will start saying, and you didn't tell us. He said, well, you know, as we were just talking, I just said that they should come home and eat. I don't know that you understand what they are talking about. Now, the husband, it's not that he's careless. That is him. Once he sees something to do, he doesn't know necessarily how to get at it. He just knows we will do it. It is the wife that is sitting back. So how do we make what he said to come to pass? When you are coming here, husband and wife, I thank God that you travel together. How many of you find it beautiful that you came together during this trip? Let me see your hand up. Alright? The last time you traveled alone, husband, when your wife was not around to pack for you, and you arrive at the conference, what happened, please? Tell me, somebody should tell me. You forgot? Yes, ma'am. Please give mama the microphone here, because we have to be practical here.
If he gets there before me and to come to that same place, he will stay there to send text of what and what and what to bring while I will be coming.
Imagine that. You wonder why he was rushing in the first place. Are you understanding? Yes, a man that is rushing, but he has forgotten his toothpaste brush. Sometimes he has already arrived before he remembered that he didn't carry his belt. So he will start and he says, please, when you are coming, don't forget. Please bring my best. Sometimes you wonder what is the makeup of a man. He was never made for details. He was made for greed, big blocks. Once his mind said, we are going to Lagos. All he's thinking about, we get to Lagos, we do this meeting. The wife is saying, when we go there, where are we going to sleep? I don't worry, we'll get somewhere to sleep. The wife is saying, will they give us water heater? Because I know that you will need hot water. Say, don't worry. But you see, when you get there, you discover that while you are rushing, your wife is calculating. If we get there and there is no hot water, let me just carry a small electric kettle or heater, so that if there is nothing, I will at least know what to do. So when you get there and your wife just puts heater to boil water for your tea, you say, when did you bring that? You say, that was what I was packing. When you were putting on the car, say, papa, 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 let's go. I know you have forgotten your handkerchief. That's what I went back the other time to go and carry. I know when you get on the buffet, you ask me for handkerchief. That's why their bags are always heavy. Are you hearing me? Their bags are heavy because of you. It's because of you. It's you that they are packing for. Hallelujah. Are we together to that point? So what does God want us to do? We need to relate with that understanding. Husbands, you need to know that your wife is not petty. That's how God wanted her to be. She needs to have details. As we are sitting here now, do you know that your wife is sitting here, we're in this meeting. If a child should call from home and say, mommy, what do I do about this? We can't see a bag of sand, we can't see salt. Do you know that while we are sitting here, your wife will say, go inside the store. There's one blue leather bag. There are three blue leather bags, but there is one that is not too deep blue. Inside it, there's another red cellophane. Inside it, there is a sachet of salt. There's another sachet that is sugar. If don't use that one. It is this one in the red bag. The other one is in the, I think that thing is gray. That's one with salt, with sugar. You are wondering how a woman is here in Lagos. And she is very, very meticulously directing small issues at home. Have you noticed that before? That's the manufacturer's design. How many of you enjoy when your wife travels for a week? Please, husband, stand up and tell me. You don't know where anything is. I know the only thing you eat throughout the time, bread and granite. Why? Because you don't just know anything. Will you like to thank God for your wife? They are the one that is putting us in shape. Hallelujah. So, we relate with each other not as equals, but with understanding of these peculiar differences. And we begin to accommodate it. when you want a meeting, so you want to go for a meeting at 9 a.m. when do you think your wife has started preparing for that journey? The journey of 9 a.m. tomorrow, when does she start preparing? She has started preparing since yesterday. You know why? She's putting everything together. We will be out of the house for 3 days. So she's thinking, what will happen to Nkechinyere? Who will come back when we are away in Lagos? What do we do for her? She's thinking. The husband says, well, thank God, when she comes back, they know what to do. That's your own attitude as a man. But the wife is saying, no. Let's arrange. And she will write notes. Leave them for the girl. When you come, this is somewhere here, this is somewhere here, this is what to do, this is what to do, this is what to do. Because of that, do we need to create time for our wives? I'm asking a question. Do we need to give them space to prepare for anything we're going to do? Eh? We need to. So a situation where you just bounce on your wife and say, we are going. She say no. We are not ready yet. Say, what are we doing again? What are we doing again? We need to go. You can see that it's not because she's sluggish. It's because she's thinking of many, many issues. Both to set at home and to set where you are going. Any other more points before you move us on to the next issue, very critical, about partnering, not as equals, not as mates, but as head and the body.
The other point I wanted to make about that, about the issue of the female valuing words, is the fact that if we say things that are wrong, it's possible that if God has not dealt with her enough, she may keep that word, and that may be against our harmony in the home. There was a lady like that. Just the first week of their wedding, because they were going somewhere where they had to climb bike in a village, Okada. They were to climb bike. They were missionaries. But, you know, these missionaries that came from the city, who has never ridden Okada before. And they got there within the honeymoon period. And the husband was saying, now we have reached where a car cannot go. We have to carry bike. They were actually going to his own home place. And the woman said, what? Okada? I've never ridden Okada in my life. Say, oh, you will ride it today. Nothing will happen. Let's go. And the woman said, no, but I've never. I don't know how to. I will fall, no? Say, no, you won't fall. Let's go. They were talking back and forth until the man got fed up and he said something. He said, but why are you troubling me like this? Why do you decide to be so strong on this matter? Do you want to disturb me? Are you Satan that one cannot beg? That word, are you Satan? Finished their marriage for the next 8 years. She was turning it around. If the man wants her to do this one, say, ah, you want Satan to help you do something? No, how can you? You have married Satan. And for 8 years, there was disharmony. It took God's grace. They had to come to our house, and it took time. I think they stayed with us for 2 years before we could sort something out from that issue. Women value words just like treasure. So we don't just speak unadvisedly. If we want to use words, let's use words to build. In the same way, women value even that simple word, I love you. It's possible that there are some men who have never said, I love you to their wife. But that word, so simple, can build your home in such a great manner that you will never think about. Just to express to her, darling, I love you. Many of us, we are stingy of that word. But that word, in fact, some women will say, I don't need money. I don't need money. But just to, you know, appreciate somebody. Just appreciate. Just words is enough. Not even money. So it's important for us to express our heart in appreciation and to use words that can build relationships, not words that can tear it down.
Thank you. Can I ask a question very quickly? Do you know that when a wife has finished making her hair, where is she rushing to show it? Eh? He wants the husband to do what? To see it and do what? And say something. Husbands, have you been saying something? Many of them, you are too much in the spirit. You close your eyes.
You don't always say, you know, you should know that I love you. Must I say it?
Uh-huh.
Please say it. We want to hear it.
Husband, are you hearing? We need to hear it. Say it. Don't say you should know. We don't know what you have not said. That's what I'm hearing the women say here. Say it. Do you know that when your wife has dressed up, she's dressing not for people outside you. You are the first person she's dressing for. Don't let it be people outside that I think you look sweet, you look great. Sometimes, because you have not said anything, she doesn't know whether you like it or not. She doesn't know whether she is dressing correctly or not. Only when she goes outside, others say, ah, mama, you look special. You say, well, but he doesn't see it. He never saw it. We are being very practical tonight. That the things that builds and releases and lubricates your marriage, they are not big things. They are not big money. They are not big gadgets. Some of you have put plenty gadgets in the house, and your wife is saying, I didn't marry television. It's you I marry. Let's go and talk. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus Christ. Please, wife, help me tell your husband that is by your side. Don't be stingy with your words to me. I need to hear you. I need to hear you. I need to be hearing you. Yes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have any more thing here before we go away?
Ephesians 5.
Alright. Praise the Lord. Before we go to Ephesians 5, and we need to discuss Ephesians 5 very quickly, Sister Shade will take us into that. But don't forget that we read 1 Peter chapter 3. And it says, likewise, you wives, be in subjection to your husband, isn't it? Now, Amplified that I asked them to read was very elaborate. I want him to repeat it again. Please repeat 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 and 2 for us. We just read it and just draw issues out. Look at the man there. Thank you. Yes, Amplified.
You married women, be submissive to your own husbands. Subordinate yourselves as being secondary to and dependent on them.
Now, be submissive to your own husbands. The word your own is very important. Sometimes, a woman is willing to submit to other men, not to her own husband. It doesn't matter how your husband looks. That's your own. That's your own. And that's the one that God is saying, submit yourself to him. Be submissive to him. But what does it mean to be submissive? That's what we are trying to read now. Go on now.
You say, subordinate yourselves as being secondary to and dependent on them.
Look at that now. As being secondary to him. In order for our relationship to grow well, wife, don't forget that you are not primary. You are secondary to him. Just know that in the way God wanted it, you are here to help, not to take over. And because of that, subordinate yourself. Make yourself a subordinate. We are not being negative. We are only learning what the word of God says. Subordinate yourself as being secondary to him. Your opinion is secondary. Your position over a matter is secondary. When we are considering a matter, when your husband has said something and you have brought in an idea, just know that what you have brought in is secondary. If he wants, he may take it. If he does not want and he says, no, you don't need to cling to it, release it. Allow him. If what you are saying is correct, oh, God knows how to bring him back to it. And when he comes back to it, he doesn't say, Did I not tell you? You are doing giri. We told you that this is what to do. And you think some of us are not thinking. No, you are overstepping your boundary. When he comes back to recognize even your opinion, you don't use that to reproach him. Excuse me, I just want us to settle that before she brings the next issues out. Please read on quickly.
And adapt yourselves to them.
Adapt yourselves. What is the meaning of adapt? What does it mean to adapt? Be flexible. Don't be rigid. Don't insist. If he says, this is where we are going, adapt. And you know something I thank God for a woman, for women. Women have capacity for flexibility. A woman can easily fit into something and you will think she's the one who originated it. Allow that capacity that God gives you to come out. It will build your marriage. Don't insist on your way. Adapt yourself to him. Go ahead.
If any do not obey the word of God, they may be won over, not by discussion.
Now, wife, winning a husband is not always by discussion, not always by argument. Sometimes when a discussion is coming and you are realizing that, hey, the way my husband is finished, you know, sometimes you are talking and you know that your husband has already hung up. Do you know when husband has already hung up? When you are talking, Yes, I'm hearing you. I'm hearing you. You know that the matter is finished. Instead of pulling it, what do I say you should do? Adapt. Just relax. God knows how to bring it back. Hallelujah. Now, go on reading.
That they may be won over, not by discussion, but by the godly life of their wives.
Yes, sir.
When they observe the pure and modest in which you conduct yourself, together with your reverence for your husband.
Now, the Bible is talking about your conduct now. Together with your reverence for your husband. Excuse me. Every husband, a man, I don't know how to express it. Men, there's something that they need. You want to say it?
That's the thought aspect of that discovery from that from the study that I said was conducted, that a man by nature needs respect. It's a need.
Are you hearing? Your husband has a need for what? For respect.
But for a woman needs love. The need, naturally, for every woman, it's a need that every woman needs to be loved. Whereas the man needs to be respected.
Did you hear that? And that's why every time I'm listening to husbands, many times when you hear that, she doesn't respect me. And the wife is saying, how do you want us to respect you? Man of God. Is it that when you talk, we should not talk? What do you mean by respect? Now, you won't know that what a man is needing in his life is a sense of accomplishment. A sense that, yes, in my house, at least I am honored. Even if they abuse me outside, let me be a king in my own house. So when a man has a reason to keep feeling that my wife is resisting me, my wife does not respect me, my wife does not listen to me, my wife does not honor me, my wife does not know that there's somebody in the house, even though the matter is so little, his reaction can become too much. Suddenly you just see him sulking. Suddenly he goes on what I call shortwave communication. You know shortwave communication? You don't know it? Good morning. Good morning. Where are you going? There. When are you coming back? Anytime. What do you like to eat? Anything. What about the children? Which children? And you know that men, they are experts in shortwave communication. Are you understanding? When he doesn't want to talk, the wife say, what does it? What is it? He's always speaking one syllable word because something has happened. Or sometimes he just comes back, and because he's a pastor, he just carry Bible. The wife is talking. And when you make a mistake, say, I'm talking to you, say, huh? So because you are talking, I should not listen to God again. You see me reading my Bible and you are saying you are talking. I should stop listening to God to listen to you? When a man is feeling that he's being robbed, his reaction usually is to withdraw, is to stand on his own, and because he can always fill up his heart with different activities. A wife is at a loss. What have we done? Why is he not talking again? Why is he spending too long a time now in the office? Why is he not coming back home? And sometimes he may decide not to eat your food. He said, if you think it's your food that is making you to ride on me, I'm not hungry. You know how many husbands have done all of that kind of thing. But wives, we just want you to know that relating with a man, don't forget he has a need. He has a need of respect. He might look as if it is ego, but I sense that even when it is not a desire to boast, he needs a desire to be boosted. Your husband needs a boost. Don't wait for him to boast before you boost him. Wife, are you hearing me? I'm only giving you a tip on how to win your husband. Don't wait for him to boast before you do what? Boost him. Tell him how precious he is. Please finish reading it so that we can take this next issue and then we can go quickly. Yes, Mom.
You are to feel for him all that reverence includes.
Yes, sir.
To respect. Refer to him.
Revere him.
Honor. Esteem.
Appreciate.
Prize. And in the woman's sense, to adore him. That is, to admire, praise, be devoted to, deeply love, and enjoy your husband.
May the Lord give you grace in the name of Jesus Christ. So, over to you. Over to you quickly. Yes, do it quickly, and then we can go on.
Ephesians chapter 5, just to talk a little about Ephesians 5, 22 and 23. Wives, submit your own husband as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Again, in partnering together, the relationship between a man and his wife hinges on this illustration that the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church. And it means God is illustrating our relationship with what obtains between the human head and the human body. The husband is the head, and the woman, the wife, is the body. And the kind of way the head relates with the body, that's the kind of way God wants us to relate together. Surely the head is different from the body. The body is big and it has different parts. And the only body that the head has is the body. And for the head also, the only head that the body has is the head. And in the head lies the different special sense organs, which is not only the head that needs it, even the body needs those sense organs. For example, the eyes are in the head, the nose is in the head, the sense of hearing is in the head, the taste is in the head, even the touch, even though the body also has a sense of touch. And then the brain that coordinates every part of the body is in the head. Somehow, God has equipped the head for its own function. And likewise, God has equipped the body for our own function. It will be abnormal for the body to want to compete with the head. Simple. it doesn't have the capacity of the head. God has not equipped the body with the equipping that he has equipped the head. So everybody should accept the way God has put it, because he has equipped us for our different functions. Now, the head, having the sight, is a responsibility for the head to see correctly for the body. The head that does not see well will injure the body. And in terms of seeing, even spiritual sight, insight, hindsight, foresight, all the time, the head sees better than the body. You can imagine somebody who is blind. Even though the hand can feel for things, that cannot be compared with the normal seeing eye. No matter how much we can see as a wife, I'm not talking about those who are not married, but as a wife, no matter how much we can see into spiritual things, by virtue of our relationship with our husband, we should recognize that the sense of seeing is located in the head. And let's defer to them when it comes to the matter of seeing well. That's when a head is a correct head.
Wow.
There are some heads that are not correct. I hope he's not here.
Don't go that way. Don't go that way.
It's part of it.
All our heads are correct here.
I said, I hope such a head is not here. But it's a hope, but that's the truth. A correct head has a normal seeing eye and a sense of hearing to be able to pick what God says very quickly, sensitively. All the taste is in the head, all the special senses. And moreover, because we don't have time, even the brain is in the head. And that, you know, when you see the working of the brain, every part of the body has a control center in the brain. Even the little toe, the little finger, has a center that controls it in the brain. And I could see that the brain, the head, does not need to shout on the leg before it will carry it where it wants. There is a flow of nerves from the head to every part of the body. There is a quiet flow of control that flows quietly to every part of the body, and the body just responds without needing to be shouted upon. If a head shouts on the leg and say, "Oh, you leg, can't you see? I say, carry me to that place." And you see a man talking to his leg like that, what will you say to that man? He needs to visit the psychiatric hospital.
He's getting mad.
If you see a head shouting on the hand and say, "Mosquito is biting my leg, kill it," and somebody is walking on the street and is saying that, you will know that that head is not correct.
It's not coordinated.
So, by virtue of the flow of nerves, there is a flow of life that commands following that God is expecting from our husband. That we don't need to shout on our wives before they will know what to do. Just by a flow of life that commands respect. You know, there is life that commands respect, that commands following. If God will help us, there won't be any quarrel, because this woman would have seen light, and you don't need to shout before she will obey. And in the same way, even the body must respond quietly and quickly by reflex to the control from the head. So that submission does not need shouting. We just need to respond according to how the Lord has endowed the head and endowed the body. So it's important for us to recognize that the husband is the head. He has all the control centers.